Good morning, everyone. We're glad that you're here, and we are looking forward to worshiping and praising God this morning, and we're looking forward to getting into the Word and hearing what God has for each one of us this morning through His Word, and may I encourage you this morning, you know, I know we've had quite a unique week as a country, but I'll tell you, there's a song that we're going to be singing. It's the last song that in the chorus of the song, it says basically that even though we don't see Him, He's working. Even though we don't feel it, He's working. He never stops working. And that's God, obviously. God never stops working. Amen? And so that's what we're going to rely on. That's the truth of all of it. God was not surprised by last week. Neither should we. He was not disturbed from last week. His will is still going to be advanced. God is God. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. We serve a risen Savior. We serve Jesus the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray this morning, Lord, for those that are on watching us electronically, those that are here in our midst, I pray, Father, for a most holy experience this morning, a most powerful experience this morning. Lord Jesus, your word is very clear that, God, you said to your people, if you seek me with all of your heart, you will find me. Lord, I know that you're not excited about a half-hearted people. And so, Lord, I pray that today we would seek you with everything. I pray today that we would worship you with everything. I pray today that we would be on the edge of our seats as the Word of God is spoken. Lord, to hear what you have to say to each one of us individually, collectively. Lord, may you encourage, may you build up, may you strengthen those of the faith. Lord, if there are some that are tuned in and they are not born again, I pray today would be their day that they would come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray for those that need to be refilled or filled for the first time with your Holy Spirit, endued with power to do that which you want us to do, and that's to lead people to the resurrected Jesus. Hallelujah. And so, God, be with us as we are ministering and as we are ministered to by your Holy Spirit this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 We are so glad that you're here again. And so you're welcome to stand. You're welcome to sit. Whatever you want to do, all I'm asking you is that you worship. Amen? Hallelujah.
Set me free, and He set me free. music with the heavens, we will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
That's better.
What's not to love about you? I am a friend of God. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
I hope so. I hope so. Because you can be if you're not. You got to come to Jesus. You can be God's friend today, right now. Invite him to be your Lord and Savior. Invite him to forgive your sins. Have him come into your life and take control of your life. God will be your friend. Hallelujah. Mm.
All right.
Running after me.
goodness above.
Hallelujah.
Stop working. never stop working. Moonmaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are. The book of Acts, Acts chapter 13. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I praise you and I thank you for your recorded words. They're not only historically sound and powerful, Lord God, it's an encouragement to me to get to know who you are more and more as I read your word. I thank you that it's a love letter to us. I thank you that it's instructional for us. But more than that, Lord God, I thank you that it's not just a book. Because, Lord, books are just books. They have a bunch of words. But, God, this book here, you back up. Hallelujah. Because you're the living God. And you said in your word very clearly, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away. And so, Lord, we trust you today to do that which you desire to do. May I not be in your way, in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to pick it up in verse 13. Last week we covered the first 12 verses. This week we're going to cover the rest of chapter 13. So Paul and his companions put out to sea from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia. But John left them and returned to Jerusalem. But going on from Perga, they arrived at Pisidian Antioch, and on the Sabbath day, they went into the synagogue and sat down. So the neat thing about it is we can kind of get a picture with these maps to see what they did. Now, you got to pretend you're in first century. They didn't have all the wonderful things that we have today. So when he got on a boat to go across, chances are it was some type of a galley. Potentially, there were men underneath the galley that had maybe a bunch of different paddles that were rowing. Maybe it was a sail, a large sailboat. Maybe it was a combination of the two. But nonetheless, it was probably somewhat uncomfortable. And so they not only sailed from Seleucia to Salamis, and they stayed on the Isle of Cyprus, but they now move over to Perga and up into Pisidian Antioch. Now, Antioch is the region. Pisidian is the area that they're ministering in and through. And so these guys were committed. Can we say that? They were committed to the call of God. Amen? And rain, snow, sleet, or hail, boat, camel, horseback, donkey ride, walk, they were committed to the things of God. They were committed to the call of God. So picking it up in verses 15, it says, after the reading of the law and the prophets, the synagogue officials sent to them saying, brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say it. So Paul stood up, motioning with his hand, said, men of Israel, and you who fear God, listen. Now, before we go into the continuation, I want to give you a little backdrop, a little history on how they used to do church in the synagogues. So this is Jewish tradition. Every Sabbath day, the Jews would enter the synagogue and hear a portion of the Torah, the law, and something from the prophets would be read as well. Sometimes they would read out of the Psalms, but they would have a large portion of Scripture that they would read. Obviously, they didn't have the New Testament work, so it would be from Genesis to Malachi. And so they would have chosen pieces of Scripture that they would read and every single Sabbath day. And now tradition teaches that the Jews would also read and sing from the Psalms. So they would actually take a psalm from the Word of God, and they would sing it to the best that they had from generation to generation, been passed down to sing a song. So some of you folks think the hymns are old. Ha! These psalms were written by, like, King David lots of years before we read about this here in the first century. And so they were singing some psalms that were old, and they were being blessed. And by the way, I don't know if you know, but our first song was actually a hymn. And that used to be something they'd use in a camp meeting. And oh, I'll tell you, when I die, if I die before my wife, she's going to have that song played over and over again. I don't care if you dance on my casket. I might be dancing in spirit in heaven. I don't know. But the point is that song is awesome. Hallelujah. He set me free. Anyway, that's what they would do. They would sing from the Psalms. Traditionally, someone from the congregation or an educated visitor would be invited to read and or give a brief meditation on how passages related to one another. We see Paul doing this at this time. We also see Jesus doing this when he entered the synagogue and he looked and found in the scroll of Isaiah the part that was about him, about his ministry and who he was. And he said, today this has been fulfilled in your hearing. So this is what they would do. But they would always invite somebody that was educated to communicate something. Now, the idea was is that you would take something from the law and the prophets and you would speak on it and then you would make it applicable for the day. Kind of sounds like what I'm trying to do today, right? What preachers try to do today. Remember the three basic disciplines of Bible study and Bible teaching? Observation, see what it says. Interpretation, see what it means. Application, how do we live this? Those are the three basic fundamental disciplines of Bible study, Bible teaching that you should know. You should never forget that. Observation, see what it says. Interpretation, what does it mean? And application, how do I apply it to my life? How can I live this thing? Amen? So that's what they would do. So this is older than me. Back into the verses. So the God of this people, this is Paul speaking, the God of this people Israel chose our fathers and made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt. And with an uplifted arm, he led them out from it. For a period of about 40 years, he put up with them in the wilderness. When he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he distributed their land as an inheritance, all of which took about 450 years. After these things, he gave them judges until Samuel the prophet. Then they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul, the son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, for 40 years. After he had removed him, he raised up David to be their king, concerning whom he also testified and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart, who will do all my will. From the descendants of this man, according to the promise of God, he has brought to Israel a Savior, Jesus. After John had proclaimed before his coming a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. So let's take a moment and think about this. Paul is taking ancient prophecy and he's tying them to the fulfillment which is found in Jesus. I don't know if you realize this, but this is evangelism 101. It really is. You have to give substance to Jesus. Jesus just wasn't born of a woman. He just wasn't born in Bethlehem. He just wasn't born in a manger or laid in a manger after his birth. He wasn't just, you know, sent to Egypt. He wasn't just brought back from Egypt and then stayed in Nazareth. There's depth to all of this, such as, number one, his preexistence before his birth. The prophecies that led to declaring and knowing who this was going to be, the manner in which he was coming, the people, the areas, through the prophets. It's deep. It's powerful. So Paul continues and he says, and while John the Baptist, was completing his course, he kept saying, what do you suppose that I am? I'm not he, but behold, one is coming after me, the sandals of whose feet I am not worthy to untie. Brethren, sons of Abraham's family and those among you who fear God, to us the message of this salvation has been sent. For those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, recognizing neither him nor the utterances of the prophets which are read every Sabbath, fulfilling these by condemning him. And though they found no ground for putting him to death, they asked Pilate that he be executed. When they had carried out all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in the tomb. I'm going to stop here for a minute. He takes the Old Testament prophets. He talks about this uniqueness of this man, Jesus, who came through the lineage of David, which also was the lineage of Judah, right? This is important. And he's got it tracked all the way to talking about John the Baptist, who I'm sure was world-renowned by this time. And so he says, John wasn't him. He even declared that he wasn't the Messiah, the Savior. But this man, Jesus, right? He was the fulfillment of the prophets. The religious leaders missed it altogether. They ended up killing him, putting him to death, and they had him executed, and he was put on a cross, and then they laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. And for many days he appeared to those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, the very ones who are now his witnesses to the people, and we preach to you the good news of the promise made to the fathers. Notice the focus on the resurrection. Please pay attention as we go through the book of Acts how often the resurrection of Christ is mentioned. It's important. That God has fulfilled this promise to our children in that he raised up Jesus, talking about the resurrection, again, same message, as it is also written in the second Psalm, "You are my son, today I have begotten you," fulfillment. "As for the fact that he raised him up from the dead," again, this is the third time now, "no longer to return to decay, he has spoken of it in this way, 'I will give you the holy and sure blessings of David.' Therefore, he also says in another psalm, 'You will not allow your Holy One to undergo decay.' For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid among his fathers and underwent decay. But he whom God raised did not undergo decay." Do you see how deep and how steep and how dissected and how much he spends on the resurrection of Christ? As the fulfillment of the scriptures. Can I ask you, number one, when's the last time you shared the gospel with anybody? Number two, when you shared the gospel, how much emphasis did you place on the resurrection of Christ? Because that's all of it right there, ladies and gentlemen. Could it be that after we serve the purpose of God, oops, I'm going way ahead of myself, sorry. "Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through him forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and through him everyone who believes is freed from all things from which you could not be freed through the law of Moses. Therefore, take heed so that the things spoken of in the prophets may not come upon you." So he talked about David fulfilling his time. He talked about John fulfilling his time. Did you ever think that God's got a purpose? You know, what's really interesting about this portion of Scripture is the way that Paul talks about our stay on earth. Did you know that Hebrews tells us that it's appointed for man once to die and then judgment? And all of us are aware that we're not getting out of here unless we die, save only the rapture. Isn't it interesting that we put so much emphasis on the living stuff? Meaning this, how much money do we spend on cosmetics? Facelifts, tummy tucks, all these different things. How to live longer. Now, is it wise that we take care of our body? Yeah, the Bible says that our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. We shouldn't abuse it. We shouldn't do anything. We've been bought with a price. The Bible says, therefore, glorify God with our body. That's not what I'm talking about. But what I'm talking about is this. For what purpose do we put so much emphasis on the physical and not the eternal? Think about this. I can't remember which prophet, it's gone from me, it'll come to me at some point, but there was this man that was studying law. This is back in, I think, the 19th century, studying law. And here's the thing that was interesting. In his classroom, he had a teacher that was born again, and he said this to him. He said, "So what's your plans?" And he says, "Well, you know, I want to finish law school." "Well, then what?" "I'd love to open up my own law firm." "Well, and then what?" "I want to get married." "And then what?" "I'd love to have a family." "And then what?" "Well, I guess and then I'm going to retire." "And then what?" This man went out in the woods and he wept for hours his way to salvation. Do you know that there is an "and then what" to each one of our lives? But here's the thing that Paul recognizes in the 13th chapter of the book of Acts. He says it very interesting. There's a fulfillment of our purpose on this planet, and when that's done, we go home. Do you hear what I'm saying? God is so in charge of our life, our existence. It saddens me when people take their lives. But it's so powerful to know that when our purpose is fulfilled, and it would seem by what Paul says, he uses two men in particular, that when our purpose is fulfilled, God takes us home. It gives, I think, greater meaning, deeper meaning to the psalm that says, God rejoices over the death of his saints. Why? Because as soon as this is gone, I'm going to be carried into the presence of my Savior, never to sin again, never to disobey him again, never to fall again, never to be hurt again, never to weep again, never to have difficulty again. There's no more crying. There's no more dying. I am going home.
Amen.
So when our purpose is complete, God takes us home. The only problem with that for us in America is this. I don't know about you, but my birth certificate does not have an expiration date. We don't know, do we? You know, it's really funny. Funny, interesting, odd, whatever. When my mother-in-law went home to be with the Lord, my wife and I were fairly young in our marriage. We were young. My oldest boy, who is going to be, he's in his 30s, was a newborn. He was a baby. I don't even think he was 9 months old. And my wife's mom went home to be with the Lord. My wife was young. My baby, the only one that ever got held by her, was my oldest boy. But here's the thing. We all went up with my father-in-law, and we all bought stuff for burial way back then. So I am a proud owner of two lots, one for her, one for me, of our resting place. I know where I'm going to go when this is done. The soul goes to heaven. This goes in the ground up in Jefferson, New Hampshire. What's my point? They give you these, well, they don't give you, you buy these big plaques. It's got your name on it, the year you were born. And for my wife and I right now, we have a space that's empty. Our purpose isn't done yet. God's purpose for us isn't finished yet. Do you know that you have a purpose? Do you know that as a Christian, you have an ordained godly purpose? And do you know what that ordained godly purpose is? To glorify him, to love him, to serve him. Hallelujah. Kind of what I'm getting from Paul. So, again, going back to Evangelism 101. Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through him forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and through him everyone who believes is freed from all things, meaning all sin, from which you could not be freed through the law of Moses. Therefore, take heed so that the things spoken of in the prophets may not come upon you. Why is Paul so intently focused on the resurrection and not the miracles? You know, there was a time, I don't think so much now, where Christianity, especially us Pentecostals, we're kind of interesting sometimes, aren't we? If only God would raise the dead, then the entire upper valley would get saved. Jesus already did that with Lazarus, and you know what happened? They got even more ambitious to want to kill him and Lazarus again. Well, that didn't work. People by the scores were healed when Jesus walked the earth. Not everybody came to him. I would even dare say this. Maybe some of the multitude that Jesus healed may have been the very same ones that were crying out, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. I don't know, I wasn't there, but it sounds like it could have been. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul tells us why. If there's anything that I want you to memorize today from this message is this. 1 Corinthians 15 is a thorough, thorough writing from Paul on the reason for the resurrection, the time of the resurrection, the person of the resurrection. The entire 15th chapter of Corinthians is dedicated to the resurrection of Christ. I believe there's like 56 verses. That's a lot of discussion. It's an exhaustive picture of the resurrection. So if you don't remember some of the scripture verses that I'm about to share, please, please, please just remember 1 Corinthians 15 and go to it anytime you want to know anything about the resurrection and its importance. Amen? So we're going to read first in verse 3 through 5. Paul says, for I delivered to you as of first importance. First importance is very, you got to pay attention to that. What I also received, that Christ died for our sin, according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Now think about this for just a moment. First importance. You see these three? First importance. That means there's nothing more important than these three things. Christ is the fulfillment of Scripture. He died for our sins according to Scripture. He was buried, and then he rose again according to Scripture. First and foremost importance that you should have in the depth of your soul as a born-again Christian, the knowledge that Jesus came to fulfill the Scriptures, forgive your sins, and we trust in him because he rose from the dead. Amen. That is first importance. That is more important than any other doctrine or theology that you and I could encompass. So he continues. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time. So when he rose from the dead, he didn't do it in secret. Most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also. See what verses 12 and on say. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there's no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. Your faith also is vain. You see why he says this is first importance? Did you know that your faith rests on the fact that Jesus rose from the dead? And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is vain. Your faith also is in vain. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. And those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who were asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all will be made alive. If we're not talking to the unsaved about the importance of resurrection, we are missing it completely. Because it's nothing different than one religion to another. Hey, Muhammad, he started a religion, big one. There's over 1 billion people that are Muslim, and he's dead, still in the grave. How can you trust him? Their faith is in vain. According to the Apostle Paul, their faith is in vain. You're saying, oh, I can't believe that you just said that publicly. Oh, no, you might get killed. Oh, goody. I don't care. I'm already dead. I have died with Christ. Therefore, it is no longer I that live. I'm going home to be with Jesus. And I'm going to call a spade. If the Bible says it's not true, it's not true. If the Bible says it's true, it's true. How can I trust it? Jesus rose from the dead. Amen. 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 And it's not just them. It's any faith, any religion, anywhere that does not believe in the fact that Christ rose from the dead. They're wrong. And I wish they'd be right. I wish they'd come to Christianity and see the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. It's of utmost importance. It's first things. Hallelujah. Continuing, verse 13 and 14, but if there is no resurrection of dead, not even Christ has been raised, and if Christ has not been raised, our preaching in vain is in vain, and your faith also is in vain. I don't know about you, but I don't like doing anything in vain. Specifically when it has to do with my soul and yours and those of you by television. Amen? It's that important. It's that important. Back to Acts. Paul talking to the religious leaders. He's quoting Old Testament. He's hoping that they're not going to go this way, but he has to quote it anyway. And he says, behold, you scoffers, and marvel and perish, for I'm accomplishing a work in your days, a work which you will never believe, though someone should describe it to you. As Paul and Barnabas were going out, the people kept begging that these things might be spoken to them the next Sabbath. Wouldn't it be awesome if people were begging to have us speak the gospel? Yeah. Amen? Yeah. Hallelujah? Now, when the meeting of the synagogue had broken up, many of the Jews and the God-fearing proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, were urging them to continue in the grace of God. The next Sabbath, nearly the whole city assembled to hear the word of the Lord. Wow, could you imagine after today, all of Lebanon is pressing in to come to church to hear more about the resurrection of Jesus? Could you imagine if all those people that watch us, by the way, last week we had over 500 views. Could you imagine if all 500 of you decided to descend upon Lebanon to come to church to hear more about the resurrection of Jesus? Oh, that would be awesome! And if you don't, keep watching by electronics. Anyway, the next, yes, but people are welcome here. The next Sabbath day, nearly the whole city assembled to hear the word of the Lord. Now listen, but when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and began contradicting the things spoken by Paul and were blaspheming. May we never become jealous with the things of God or his word. They were blaspheming. That's scary. You know, I don't care if there's a Bible preaching, Bible teaching Baptist church that has more people than I do. Praise God. I don't care if there's a Methodist church that's a Bible teaching, Bible preaching church that has more people in their sanctuary than I do. I don't care. Praise God. I don't care if there's a non-denominational church that upholds the word of God, preaches the resurrection of Christ, preaches the whole truth of the gospel, and they're filled more than our church is filled. Praise God. May we never succumb to jealousy. Never succumb to jealousy. Never succumb to jealousy, please. It's ruinous. It's ruinous for us. It's ruinous for our cause. It's ruinous for Christ's kingdom. May we never become jealous. So Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly and said, it was necessary that the word of God be spoken to you first. Since you repudiated it and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life, behold, we are turning to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us, I have placed you as a light for the Gentiles that you may bring salvation to the end of the earth. When the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. As many as been appointed to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was being spread through the whole region. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to stop here for a moment, briefly. I believe that we're on the potential precipice of opportunity. Think about it. The stuff that happened last week. What if somebody has all of their trust in our leadership? And I don't know about you, but I'm just seeing some things that I'm not real comfortable with what's coming. But let's just pretend now that there are some folks in our reach, in our, you know, that are just so anxious because of the change, angry because of the change. You name it. You put any kind of a feeling and emotion next to the, I'm concerned about this change. And then they see us. How come you're not riddled with the same anxiety we are? Let's talk about Jesus. Let's talk about Jesus. Let's talk about who he is, how he was proclaimed in the Old Testament. He was the fulfillment, how he came to forgive us of our sins. You remember that little piece we read in the book of Acts about the law? Do you know what's interesting? Do you know how many people, even in the Christian faith, sometimes when they're young in the Lord and they got to learn and work this stuff out, some people think that it's about good behavior that you're going to make it in with God. That's the law. And the Bible says this, our good works are as filthy rags before God. Why? Because once you're a criminal, all of your good stuff is unrecognizable. Think about this for just a moment. Let's just pretend that today I raped somebody. I know you're like, I can't believe you just said this in church. What if I did? How would you look at me? I know how you'd look at me, because I'd look at me the same way. How could you? You're evil. I can't believe you did that. You violated somebody. Oh, my goodness. What happened to all my good works? What happened to all my preaching? What happened to all my doing? Gone. What are we going to look at? The rapist. What if it was your neighbor? Mowed your lawns. What a good guy. Just can't believe he did this. Where does the good guy status go? It's gone. Do you know that every single sin that we commit is breaking the law of God? And so when God sees us being holy and absolute perfect, and he sees us breaking those laws, in his heart, and it's descriptive in the scriptures, we're lawbreakers to him, criminals. That's why the Bible says that before we come to Christ, we're at enmity with God. We're at war with God. He sees us as criminals. All the good that we do is extinguished by the breaking of God's law every time we do it. So Paul is saying, if you're trusting in the fact that you're upholding the law, you're going to die in your sins. There's no repentance in the law. So if we think that we're going to stand before God and our good is going to outweigh our bad, we have no idea what the Bible teaches about a holiness of God. The holiness of God can't stand the presence of rebellion. As a matter of fact, there's a really powerful portion of Scripture. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 15, where it says this, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. So in other words, it equates our rebellion against God as if we were in witchcraft already. So Paul is saying, if you think that today you were nice to your neighbor and that's going to make a one-up on God, you're mistaken. The law is not going to save you, because what Jesus did is, like any court, when we break a law, there's a fine to be paid, whether it's prison or monetary or whatever, there's a fine that must be paid. The holiness of God requires payment for our sin. It requires it. His holiness requires the payment for our sin. And no amount of sacrifices, no amount of coming to church, no amount of Bible reading, no amount of praying is going to help you, because every single one, God equates it to witchcraft. So what does that mean for us? We break God's law, we stand before him, and in heaven there's no monetary exchange. In other words, I'm not going to be able to give God $10 or $100 or $1 million to satisfy the breaking of his laws. There's only one thing that satisfies that, and that's Jesus. See, what Jesus did 2,000 years ago, he came and he took the payment on our behalf. He paid the debt that we owe and couldn't pay. He paid the debt we owe and couldn't pay. He didn't deserve to, but he did because of his love for us. So when he came and he gave his life for us, it was more than just hanging on a tree. If that's all we see with what he did, we're missing the whole point. He paid the debt. So here's the deal, and Paul's explaining it. When Jesus came and paid that debt, he satisfied hell, the payment for our debt, on our behalf. Meaning this, even though none of us, including myself, and especially myself, has the right to be arrogant and to be proud as a Christian, because we miss the fact that it's through humility we come. It wasn't because of me that God died, in the sense that, oh, you know, Kevin's a pretty good guy, I think I'll die for him. It's because of his love he came and he gave his life, so that as I invite Jesus to forgive my sin, to cleanse my sin, I accept his payment on my behalf. All of a sudden, when I stand before God, unworthy as I am, sinner that I've been, when I stand before God, the holiness of God, there's something that's in heaven that's exciting. And it's called the Lamb's Book of Life. And when we accept the payment that God made on our behalf through his son Jesus, Jesus writes the name in that Lamb's Book of Life. I almost wonder if it's in red like your Bible is with Jesus' words. I almost wonder if Kevin Horion's name is in that Lamb's Book of Life in red as a remembrance or a reminder. Maybe I'll have the opportunity to see that written in the book, a red reminding me of the blood that was poured and shed for my sin. On that day when I stand before God and I see or I hear that my name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, are you ready? God's going to say, your penalty has been fulfilled and paid for. You can enter into life. Amen. Evangelism, ladies and gentlemen, 101. Anything different than that is not evangelism according to the Scriptures. How can I trust in that? Because Jesus, being the perfect sacrifice, died and the grave couldn't hold him. Because he was more than just man, and he was absolute perfection. He paid the debt that I owe. Amen? That's the word of the Lord that needs to be spread through the whole world, this whole region. Because that's what the Scriptures teach. But there was a little bit of backlash. But the Jews incited the devout women of prominence and the leading men of the city and instigated a persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of their district. But they shook off the dust of their feet and protested against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were continually filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. So I want to challenge us today. If you're here this morning and you do not know Jesus, do you know you can today? If you do not have, if we'll call it eternal security, in the fact that you know that Jesus, you have given him your life, you have given him all, you've accepted his payment, you've repented, you've asked him to cleanse and forgive your sin. If you've not done that, may I encourage you to do that today? You can. Because remember, we have a time frame. And none of us really know what that time frame is. We don't know how long we're going to live. When some of us feel like somebody dies too young, well, God wasn't surprised. Do you know the one thing that God will not do when I stand in front of him? You're 15 minutes early. What are you doing here? Or he won't be like, oh, you're 3 weeks too late. What are you doing? Didn't you pay attention? That's just not going to happen. Are you ready to meet Jesus in your last days? Christian, why wouldn't you want to share this incredible news with as many as you can? To have your sins forgiven? Oh, it's absolutely the most gratifying, intense thing that could ever happen. To know in your heart that you're on your way to an eternity with God in heaven, never to cry, never to die. Oh my goodness, to be in the presence of your Savior. What a privilege. Thanks for joining with us this morning. I know we were a little long, but I personally believe it was worth it. God bless you. Hallelujah.